Welcome along, fellow time travelers and strange historians. This time around, we're going to travel back in time to discover why many people believe the Dakota is haunted. Before I begin, please like and share the show, and subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell. Now please join me around the campfire. If you are listening to my voice right now, it means you are not dead. Yet. And if you aren't dead, that means you aren't a ghost. And if you aren't a ghost, that means you most certainly never haunted the Dakota apartment building in New York City. But does that mean that no ghosts ever have? People around the world believe that the Dakota is haunted by ghosts. You might be one of those believers. In this series about the Dakota being haunted, I'm going to explain why some people believe that, and together, you and I will try to discover if those people are right. The Dakota, an iconic apartment building in New York City, is famous not only for its distinctive architecture and celebrity residence, but also for its association with various ghost stories and legends of hauntings. This building, located at the northwest corner of West 72nd Street and Central Park West in Manhattan, was completed in 1884 and has since accumulated a rich tapestry of tales, some eerie and others tragic. Some say there are stories of supernatural hauntings that have happened there. As you know, the most famous death associated with the Dakota is that of John Lennon, the former Beatle, who was murdered in front of the building on December 8, 1980. His death has spawned various ghost sightings. Some people have claimed to have seen a spirit in and around the building. It is here, by the ornate, wrought iron gates of the building, that passersby have reported their eerie encounters with the spirit of John Lennon. Some have claimed to have seen a figure resembling John, dressed in his iconic style, round glasses and long hair, gazing out from the shadows or walking the perimeter as if in contemplation of a song left unsung. Lennon loved the Dakota. It was his home, a sanctuary in the bustling city, where he lived with his wife Yoko Ono and their son Sean. His attachment to this place was profound, and perhaps it is this deep bond that tethers his spirit to these grounds. Those who have claimed to have glimpsed his ghost say it often happens in the late evening hours, when the city quiets down and the hustle of the day fades into the muted tones of night. It's as if his spirit prefers the calm, perhaps reminiscent of the quiet he sought in his life amidst the cacophony of fame. Some encounters are fleeting. A quick glimpse of a figure turning a corner, the rustle of a tree in strawberry fields when no wind blows. Others feel a deeper presence, a sense of peace, or an unexplained chill in the air. A few even whisper of hearing faint strains of music, a melody from nowhere, evoking the songs that once echoed within the walls of his grand apartment. The Dakota, for all its grandeur and beauty, is a place steeped in history and mystery. The tales of John Lennon's apparition are just one thread in the rich tapestry of stories woven through its halls. Whether these sightings are manifestations of the collective mourning of his fans, echoes of history, or something truly supernatural, they add to the mystique of this historic landmark. So as we sit by this crackling campfire, let the thought of John Lennon's spirit roaming the Dakota remind us that some places hold onto the essence of those who love them. And maybe, just maybe, if you find yourself walking by the Dakota on a quiet, starless night, you might catch a glimpse of John, still at home in his beloved refuge outside of the Dakota. John Lennon's death was not the only time the death of a Dakota resident caused a major disruption in the normal routine of New Yorkers. In March of 1911, the city of New York paused in a rare and solemn tribute to honor John B. McDonald, the man behind New York's iconic subway system. On the day of his funeral, the entire subway system stood still for 2 minutes to commemorate his passing, a profound gesture reflecting his impact on the metropolis. John B. McDonald, who resided at the prestigious Dakota Apartment Building, was celebrated not just as an engineer, but as a visionary who fundamentally shaped New York City. His funeral services began at St. Patrick's Cathedral, overseen by Archbishop Farley and 6 other priests, marking a significant city event. At precisely 10:30 a.m., as the cathedral's chimes echoed, H.C. Stott, the subway superintendent of Motive Power, orchestrated a complete halt of the subway operations. He turned off the main power switch at the power station on 59th Street, simultaneously sending a signal that darkened all subway stations and stilled every train. This act left the cars in pitch darkness, a dramatic tribute that underscored the magnitude of the moment. For those 2 minutes, as New Yorkers stood in the dim subway cars, many removed their hats in respect, aware of the homage being paid. The subway system, usually a throbbing vein of the city, reflected a moment of collective mourning and respect. This interruption was carefully planned to ensure safety, with no trains scheduled in critical areas like the East River and Harlem River tunnels during the power outage. After the brief pause, life pulsed back through the city's veins as power was restored at 10:32 a.m. The symbolism of the moment was not lost on the city's residents. Black drapes adorned ticket booths, and the gesture of the halted trains spoke volumes of the respect and gratitude New Yorkers felt for McDonald. His legacy as the architect of the subway system continues to touch the lives of millions daily, a testament to his lasting influence on the city's landscape and its people. To date, no one has seen the ghost of John B. McDonald, though his life at the Dakota is immortalized forever. But John Lennon and John B. McDonald were not the only persons to have died at the Dakota. Many residents have, as have some workers, though there have been no specific stories of them haunting the building. Their deaths have contributed to the building's mystique. On November 6, 1890, a chilling incident unfolded that had become a whispered tale among the residents. It was late one evening when Charles Cloney, a playful but reckless waiter at the Dakota, made a fateful decision that turned the night's quiet into a haunting memory. Nora Mulvihill, a young servant in the building, was waiting with a friend to ascend to the upper stories using one of the freight elevators. The elevator man was nowhere to be seen, and Cloney, seizing an opportunity for mischief, impulsively pulled Nora onto the elevator. In a moment of misguided jest, he started the machinery himself. As the elevator jerked into motion, Nora, seized by panic, tried to leap free, but tragedy struck in a heartbeat. Her head was caught between the moving elevator and the stationary floor. This horrific scene left Nora with a compound fracture of the skull, her condition so grave that whispers of death floated through the corridors of the Dakota. The law was swift with Cloney. Justice Meade, presiding over the Harlem court, committed him without bail, holding him responsible for the serious injuries inflicted upon Nora. As the nights passed, the residents of the Dakota spoke of the incident in hushed tones, the story serving as a grim reminder of the fine line between playful antics and perilous outcomes. This tale cautions many about the unintended consequences of a moment's folly. But Nora's death wasn't the only one involving one of the Dakota's many elevators. A year later, in 1891, in the dim light of an early morning, young Thomas Ryan, an elevator boy, known for his cheerful demeanor, was performing his daily duties. On this particular day, his task was to deliver a bundle to the fourth floor. The task was routine, and Thomas had done it countless times before, but today was different. As Thomas deposited the bundle and hurried back to his elevator, a sudden rush led him to pull the control cord with more force than intended. In that split second, the elevator lurched unexpectedly, and Thomas, caught off guard, was trapped. The machinery, merciless in its motion, caught him and crushed him against the structure of the elevator shaft. Inside the car, a quick-thinking servant witnessed the horror and managed to stop the elevator, but it was too late for Thomas. His crushed body plummeted tragically to the bottom of the shaft. The impact was deadly, and the echo of the fall reverberated through the Dakota, leaving a somber silence in its wake. The coroner was called to the scene, a grim reminder of how life can be taken by machinery. And then there's the story of the crying lady ghost. You see, there are tales of a ghostly figure of a woman seen crying in the hallways, which some have speculated might be connected to a former resident or a tragic event within the building. It all began one stormy evening when a tenant, returning late from a long day at work, heard the faint sound of sobbing echoing through the dimly lit hallway. The Dakota, known for its ornate architecture and illustrious residence, was no stranger to tales of the unexplained. But this was unlike any before. As the tenant crept closer, the sobbing grew louder. There, beneath the flickering light of an antique chandelier, stood the translucent figure of a woman. Her face was buried in her hands, her dress a flowing silhouette that swayed with a sorrow that seemed as old as the building itself. The ghostly woman, known to some as the Weeping Lady of the Dakota, was rumored to be the spirit of a former resident, perhaps a renowned actress from the early 20th century, whose life ended in a tragic mishap within these very walls. Others speculated that she was the manifestation of a collective sorrow, bound to some long-forgotten tragedy that occurred in the Dakota. Night after night, she appeared at the same spot, her cries, a haunting lullaby that filled the halls. Those who tried to approach her found that she vanished as they drew near, leaving behind a chilling draft and the faint scent of lilacs, said to be her favorite flower. The story of the Weeping Lady has become a favorite among those who gather around fireplaces within Dakota apartments. With each telling, her legend grew, intertwining with the fabric of the city's own myths and mysteries. Some residents of the Dakota, as well as their guests and visitors, who might be skeptics by day, oftentimes hope to catch a glimpse of the sorrowful apparition, or perhaps to soothe her anguish with their presence. And so the Weeping Lady of the Dakota lingers, a ghostly sentinel of the past, her story, an eternal whisper in the bustling city, reminding all of the thin veil between the present and the spectral remnants of yesteryears. And then there's the story of an apparition that has been reportedly seen playing with a ball. She is described as a little girl wearing a turn-of-the-century dress and is one of the more frequently mentioned ghost stories among the Dakota's lore. As the legend goes, on chilly evenings, when the mist from the Hudson River creeps through the streets of Manhattan, the residents of the Dakota might hear the soft bouncing of a ball along the ornate corridors of this historic building. Some say it's just the wind, or the echoes of a city that never sleeps. But those who have seen her know differently. The little girl, as she is tenderly known, appears dressed in a turn-of-the-century Victorian dress, her hair tied back with a ribbon that matches the fabric of her faded frock. She is often seen in the quieter parts of the building, especially near the old playroom in the attic. With a solemn face, she plays alone, bouncing her ball against the floor, each thud a hollow heartbeat in the vast silent hallways. Residents recount their encounters with a mix of fear and fascination. Some have stumbled upon her while wandering the halls late at night, only to see her vanish as they approach. Others have only heard the echo of her ball, a sound that stirs memories of a bygone era. One particular story that adds a haunting depth to her tale involves a longtime doorman of the Dakota, who claimed to have seen the little girl regularly during his night shifts. According to him, she once paused her play and looked up with a wistful smile, as if inviting him to join her in her lonely game. But as he stepped closer, she dissolved into the air, leaving only the sound of her laughter and the fading echo of her ball bouncing down the corridor. It is said that she might be the ghost of a former resident's daughter who lived in the Dakota in the early 1900s and tragically died young. Her presence serves as a poignant reminder of the layers of history within the walls of the Dakota, and her spirit, playful yet trapped in time, continues to inhabit the shadowy corners of this magnificent building. So, on your next stroll near the Dakota, on a misty evening, listen closely, for you just might hear the soft bounce of a ball, and if you're brave enough, you might catch a glimpse of the little girl in Victorian dress, as seen through an attic window, continuing her eternal playtime within the haunted halls of the Dakota's history. In the shadow of Central Park, where the city's hustle whispers against the rustling leaves, stands the Dakota, a looming structure that has been a New York City landmark since the late 19th century. Its construction was the brainchild of Edward C. Clarke, a visionary businessman whose dreams were as grand as the building he envisioned. Yet Clarke never saw his masterpiece completed. He died in 1882, leaving the Dakota's future in the hands of fate. Legend has it that Clark's spirit did not find peace in the afterlife. Instead, it roams through the courtyard and the hallways and basement and many of the apartments of the Dakota. A spectral figure in a bygone businessman's attire, perhaps mourning the life and opportunities lost with his untimely death. On stormy nights, when the wind howls through the arches and crevices of the old building, some residents have reported seeing the ghost of Edward C. Clarke. He appears deep in thought, wandering from room to room, his expression a mixture of awe and melancholy. It's as if he's inspecting the cornices and moldings, the fireplaces, the staircases, and other areas, making sure every detail was realized as he had dreamt. Others say that he lingers in a vast apartment overlooking Central Park, the very apartment he intended for himself and his family. Residents whisper about hearing soft footsteps in the corridors late at night, following the creaking of the doors as if someone were peeking in, curious about the modern lives lived within the walls he erected. Some believe Clark's ghost is searching for a glimpse of what his family's life might have been like if he had lived to see the building completed. Perhaps he is trying to experience, even in death, the life that slipped through his fingers. He watches over the residents, not with malice, but a kind of longing and a fatherly protectiveness for the architectural child he left behind. though he is a figure from another century, his presence is as ingrained in the Dakota as the very bricks and mortar. And so you may wonder whether Edward C. Clarke finds solace in seeing his grand creation teeming with life, or whether he yearns eternally for the days he never got to live there, overlooking the green expanse of Central Park. All of the stories that you have heard and will hear contribute to the Dakota's mystique and have been part of its legend for years. There has been a great deal of skepticism about these supernatural claims. After all, no concrete evidence has been presented to confirm any hauntings, and many attribute these stories to the building's old age, its architectural style, and its history with high-profile tragedies, like John Lennon's murder. Furthermore, psychological factors such as the power of suggestion and the fame of the building could also play roles in the propagation of ghost stories. Whether the stories of ghosts and supernatural happenings are manifestations of actual paranormal activities or simply the result of the building's dramatic history and high-profile incidents influencing the imaginations of Dakota residents and visitors and others who have been there, they are now a firmly embedded part of the Dakota's strange history. So, what do you think of the Dakota being haunted? Are you one of the believers? If so, tell me why in the comments below. Kindly remember to like, share, and subscribe, and hit the notification bell, because there will be more shows like this one, and I hope you'll check those out too. Please check out the links below to learn how to support my research and productions, specifically, and really appreciate it if you could become a member of my channel and or join me on Patreon. You could also leave a super thanks in the comments below. Kindly be kind to all of our fellow Earthlings, and please don't harm or eat them. You most certainly do not want to wake up one night and be surrounded by the ghosts of all the non-human animals who died because you harmed or ate them. Remember, for the benefit of compassion for all living things and their own health, brilliant people throughout history chose a plant-based diet. And please do yourself a favor and go to a local shelter and adopt a cat or a dog or both. You and they will be very glad that you did. Until next time, I wish you safe travels on all your journeys.